something we're going to start doing. But I want to start off and tell you a little story. Today's sermon is Sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. But when I became a child of God back in 1995, I didn't do it your normal traditional way. What happened is there was this woman named Tola. And I was a parking lot attendant, drug addict, alcoholic, all kinds of issues. Lived in the West End of Louisville. My parents were dope heads. There was nothing in me that people would see as redeemable, except someone who could see past my natural man and see into the spirit. Because see, when I was a young child, I remember hearing a voice. And that voice said, "You're not normal." Now, I already knew that, but, you know, right, Jose? I'm not normal. And he said, "You're called, and you're going to be a preacher." Now, I've shared this before, and I just kind of ignored it because I was like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. But life went on, and I followed the pattern of my parents and followed the pattern of my neighborhood, my community, because my community was a big drug community. As a matter of fact, for some of the U30s, you're going to get a tour of my life on April 27th. And if there's anybody else that wants to do a tour, I'll do one for YouTube. We'll take the church van, and I'll show you around my old neighborhood and tell you my story. But in that tour, I'm going to start at the house I was born in. Well, I wasn't born in the house, but you get the point. The house where I was spent the first few months of my life, and kind of move on and show God's redemptive story in my life. But as I got this job as a parking valet, I started having a lot of time on my hands, because in downtown Louisville, parking is really busy early in the morning, and it's really busy late in the afternoon, and then you get like a little halfway busy during lunch, and then you have these like 2 and 3 hour pockets where there's not a whole lot to do. And the reception was terrible in this little building I worked in. I had this little TV, and the only thing I could get was TBN. So I started watching John Hagee and Joyce Meyer and some of the very popular ones. And I started listening to Christian radio. I started listening to Bob Russell. Started listening to J. Vernon McGee and the Bible Bus. Started listening to all these preachers and began to get this word poured into me. And there was this young lady. I would valet park her car, and she had the radio on WJIE. Now, we know that WJIE is fairly vanilla, but I was unsaved. And I would find myself sitting in her car listening to music. And it's just like it was breathing something into me. And then, by no fluke of circumstances, this woman named Tola, it was near Christmas time, and she said, "I'm going to give you 12 gifts for the 12 days of Christmas." And she gave me like 12 pieces of candy, 11 this, 11 that, down to one. And on day number one, she gave me a Bible. And I began to read that Bible. It was the New Life Study Bible. I have no idea where it is, and I really just super regret the fact that I didn't keep up with it. But I began to read it. And I began to read its words, and something started happening to me. I didn't get saved till some later. But I saw the stories in this Bible, and I was like, are these real? Is this actually possible? Can people really get healed? Can a man with lame legs actually get up and walk? And I started hungering and thirsting for those things, excuse me. But I didn't know what to do. But I kept that Bible with me every day. And every now and then, Tola would come by, and she'd see me reading it, and she'd ask, you know, "Are you enjoying it?" And I was like, "Yeah, it's really interesting." She knew I wasn't saved. She probably smelled the pot on me when I came to work. You know, she probably knew. But you know what she never did? She never condemned me. She would encourage me, and, you know, just in passing, just a few moments. Matter of fact, how many of y'all remember the Shepherd's Guide way back in the day in Louisville? Anybody remember that? Her and her husband owned the Shepherd's Guide. That was what they did. And I started searching for churches, because I was a Catholic at the time, and I didn't see any real power in the Catholic church I was attending. So I started kind of bouncing around. I went to this one, I went to that one. And I began to grow frustrated, because I knew what I read. Something about Acts chapter 2 just stood out to me as I was reading this. And this is really my life. This is a real story. I'm not making this up. And I got mad. And I thought, okay, maybe this isn't true. Maybe these are just words on a page. But every time I read them, it was like some kind of life came into me. I felt like it was alive. And I struggled to rectify what I was seeing in life versus what I was reading in this word. And I was like, this has got to be more than a story. So you know what I did? I got worse. I turned to drugs more. I turned to alcohol more. I turned to my lifestyle more. And I started cussing more. Because I was like, you know what? If it's not real, I'm going to do the opposite. But I still carried my Bible around everywhere I went. And there was this dude named Larry. Please bear with me on this story. There was this dude named Larry. And he came up to me, and he was the one that relieved me during lunch. So I could take my lunch. And he said, Scott, which is what they called me back then, can I ask you a question? And I said, what's that? Why are you always cussing? Why do you have such a dirty mouth? I was like, I don't know. It's just kind of the way I've always been. He said, yeah, but you're carrying around that Bible. And I said, well, it's probably because I can't find a church that looks like this. And then the words he said got my attention. He said, I know of one. That's what I said. All right. He said, I'll meet you there Sunday. He gave us the address. I didn't have a car at the time, so Beth, who was my girlfriend at the time, we took a TARC bus to the place. And it was a little weird, and some weird things happened, and that's not really the moral of this story. Larry didn't show up. Beth and I went. Larry didn't show up. We saw a bunch of people we don't know. The first person that greeted me was a man named Willard Dorton. And in the back is Becky. Her maiden name is Dorton. It was her uncle. Small world. He talked with a voice box because cancer had stolen his voice because he'd smoked cigarettes for years. But he handed me a magazine, and that magazine had a picture of David Robinson on it, who was a center for San Antonio Spurs at the time. And I love basketball, I love sports, and I saw that, and I was like, that's kind of cool. I went back the next week, and there was a man with a mullet. And I'm not kidding. A man with a mullet is glorious and blonde, wasn't it? He was kind of pretty, to be honest. I can't help it. His hair was just beautiful. And he talked about Jesus. And he talked about the blood. And he talked about the power of Jesus' blood to cleanse sins. Because, see, there was one thing I wanted more than anything. I wanted out of the life I'd been living. I wanted out. I loved this girl. And I didn't want to ruin either of our lives by being a dope head. I quit drugs, I jokingly say, 491 times. The 491st time I had help. And his name was Jesus. And his blood cleansed me from my sins. And he set me free on July 23rd, 1995. I'll never forget the day. I'll never forget where I was sitting. I will never forget the smell. I will never forget the atmosphere. And that's when this book became real to me. That's when this book became life to me. That's when I recognized this is more than instructions. See, I hate the shirt that says basic instructions before leaving Earth. This is not instructions. Instructions is something you ignore. Any men identify, I don't need no instructions. I'll look at the pictures and figure it out. And at the end, what do you say? What's all this extra stuff for? I'd be fine. Right? I wonder how much extra stuff we leave on the floor because we treat this like instructions. When it's actually a sword. It's a weapon. And it's powerful. And it's able to take us exactly where it claims. It's real. If you'll turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 6 through 8, or 10 through 18, my goal as a pastor is really couple of things. Number one, I want to see people saved that were just like me. And number two, I want to see the saved fully equipped. See, in Acts chapter 2, I see a church that has power over elements, power over sickness, power over government. It says that fear and awe followed them. I see a church that's fully devoted. I see a church that's fully together. In Ephesians 4, I see a church that's fully equipped. It says, and God gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That's why we honor the fivefold ministry at Lakeside Worship Center. That's why we honor the apostolic voice, like an Elder Robinson. The prophetic voice, like a Dr. Norum. The shepherding voice, like so many of, we got several shepherds in this congregation. The teaching voice, like a Dr. Robinson. And the evangelistic voice, like Jake Robinson. No relation, by the way. Although they look almost just alike. It's kind of astonishing. No relation. And then Ephesians 6, the armor. See, I believe if a church possesses those three things, number one, an Acts 2 passion, an Acts 4 equipment, and an Acts 6 outfit, I see a church that cannot be defeated. That is my goal, to build an impenetrable force that can take this city for Jesus. Pastor Ricardo had a dream some weeks ago, and in this dream, there were several different cultures coming into this congregation. And this dude in red, he's one of my favorite dudes in his dream. He said a word that sounded like Gaon. Took us about 2 days to find that Hebrew word, but it means diversity. And it's something we've been pursuing. He's had about 8 dreams that have been revealing Hebrew words. It's pretty powerful. With that said, let's start in verse 10 of Acts chapter 6. It says, finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers over this present darkness, and against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. There are 4 realms of demonic attack. And this talks about it. I've preached on this some time ago. Don't have time today, but just know that it reveals those 4 for a reason. And it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Having done all to stand firm, stand therefore, having fastened the belt of truth. And we talked about that. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, putting on readiness given by the gospel of peace. And that's what we're going to talk about next week for Resurrection Sunday. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which we covered either last week or the week before, in which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. We covered that a few weeks ago. To that end, keep alert with perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. See, when I dive into the word of God, here's what I see. I see a world where miracles are normal. I see a world where healings are no big deal. I see a world where the miraculous is expected. Power is expected. As a matter of fact, Paul told Timothy in the last days, one of the problems with the church is they'll have the form or appearance of godliness, but deny the power. See, I'm not in ministry to give cute speeches and nice concerts. I'm in ministry because I believe in the power. Dunamis. That word dunamis, power, it's where the English word dynamite is derived from, to give you an idea. Now, it doesn't mean dynamite, because dynamite wasn't even a thing back then. But that's where we got that word from, dunamis. It's big power. It's overwhelming power. Dynamite, don't know if anybody's ridden 313 going on to I-65, but if you drive that, you see the power of dynamite. Because that used to be nothing but a big rock. Now there's a road right through that rock. I see a church that was so powerful that people flocked to Peter, and when they couldn't reach him, they got to his shadow and still got healed. I see a church so powerful that by Acts chapter 19, Paul was so busy and spread so thin that he would preach and put aprons on and cut them into pieces and send them to people, and people would get delivered from demonic forces and they would get healed. And see, that's what attracted me to this book when I was not saved. Because I saw the power that it possessed. I saw a church so powerful. It says fear and awe. You know how many sitcoms would have made fun of the first century church? Not one. Why? Because of terror. See, I think the problem today, and the reason the churches are the butt of jokes, is because we're too busy treating this like an instruction manual instead of a sword. I want to take you to Hebrews 4:12. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. So see, it's not just a sword. It is a two-edged sword, and it's not just a two-edged sword. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. Listen to its capabilities. Piercing to the division of soul and spirit. Do you realize that your soul and your spirit are essentially one thing but can be divided into two things but only by the sword? And he gives an example, bone or joints and marrow. You know, bone and marrow are two substances, but they make one thing. They can be separated and extracted. That's how powerful the Word of God is. It can separate even the most finite things. So it's discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The reason the Bible had the effect on me as an unbeliever that it did is because it's the only book that is alive. See, I was reading it, but it was also reading me. It was penetrating me. It was changing me. It was transforming me. You can't read the Bible and not have some sort of reaction to it. Why do you think so many people are so opposed to it? Being on walls and schools and in government places, why? Because it pierces. It's alive. See, because its author isn't dead. And see, its author has a vantage point that no one else in history has. He's omnipresent, means he's everywhere. He's omniscient, which means he knows everything. He owns everything too. It points us to a reality that can only be given by the man or the God that made all this. And what I love about it is when we get to the New Testament, it announces the kingdom of God is at hand. It announces that a new king has come to take his throne. And see, here's my issue with a lot of churches. A lot of churches make a lot of announcements. Right? We need nurses for workers for the nursery. We need this. We're going to have a work day. We're going to have this. We're going to do that. But see, we announce those things, don't get me wrong, but the main announcement of the church is the announcement that the kingdom of God is at hand. The main announcement of the church is that Jesus came to save sinners, that he came to heal the sick, to cleanse the lepers, to fill people with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and power to witness, power to see change in our communities. Lakeside's mission is to announce the kingdom of God has come to Hardin County. And that is the very thing that we're going to do. And the Bible says in every tribe, and every nation, and every tongue, and that is our goal. Our goal is to see not only all sorts of people from all sorts of nations just because it looks like heaven. What's really funny is that God answers prayer. It was supposed to be storming right now, and I prayed that the weather would clear up. But I prayed a bold prayer some years ago. I said, God, send us the nations. And he asked me, what do you want first? So I asked for the hard one. I said, God, send us Africa. And lo and behold, God answered. And people from African nations began to come to this church, and not only come, but contribute in a major way. Bring something that, and one thing, Dr. Norm, that you really brought to my attention was the difference in the way Americans view kingdom. And you brought a level of understanding only someone who had lived that could bring. And it opened my eyes. See, that's why God loves diversity. God loves diversity because they bring a perspective that we can't have unless we experience it. So God is sending the nations here. Many of them, it's been through adoption. But I think we have 11 nations represented at Lakeside. And that's nice. It's cute. But now I'm asking God for Latin American speaking nations that are right here in our front door. And as a board, we are starting to work on a plan to make that happen. And we're going to be discussing that even more so today. And God is sending people to meet that need. And I've also been asking God for Asia to begin to send people from Korea, north and south. Send people from China, Japan, you name it, Vietnam. I'm asking him for all the nations, but when he says which one, I figure I better have an answer. When you read the Bible, something inside of you wants to live. It's like it's calling you into something more. Notice it says it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's more than a weapon, it's power. It points us to a reality that so few live far below. So I'm going to share three quick things with you about the Word, and then we'll have an altar time, receive members, and trust God to do what He did with me, change lives. The first thing about the Word of God that I notice is it destroys the attacks of Satan. Go with me to Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. It'll be on the screen if you don't have your Bibles with you. But Jesus is being tempted in the wilderness. And of course, old Satan, as they call him back in the day, old Slewfoot, was there. And it says, when Jesus was led up to the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. But Jesus answered him and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will give his angels command over you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone. So see, Satan was like, okay, two can play that game. I'll quote some scripture too. Out of context. Jesus said to him, again, it is written, you should not put your Lord your God to the test. And the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world with their glory. Now I want to stop there for a minute because that's significant. What does the Bible call Satan? The God of this world. That means that he has a kingdom. Right? As a matter of fact, Jesus said, any kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. He said, and Satan, if he was divided, his kingdom would fall. So see, Satan has a kingdom. He has kings and princes set up in order, and its purpose is to defy, to destroy, to steal, and to kill from the kingdom of God. But he can't do it. So he shows him all the kingdoms, and he says to him, all these I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me. He offered Jesus the easy way out because he knew Jesus was called to be a king. He says, I can hook you up with that. Just take the easy way out. Folks, there is no easy way. Matter of fact, in Matthew 7, it says the easy way leads to destruction. It's only the narrow way that leads to life. That's why it's hard to be a child of God. That's why so many go to fluff churches that do nothing but fluff people up and fill up seats. And I'm not opposed to big churches. I'm opposed to fluff messages. Jesus said to him, be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and only him shall you serve. And listen to what verse 11 says. And the devil left him. And behold, angels came and were ministering to him. Do you want the devil to leave you alone? The Bible says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. You begin to use your heart like a storehouse for the word of God. Turn off the television. I said, turn off the television. Thank you. I knew if I said it enough times, somebody would eventually say amen, so I'd move on. Turn off the television. Get in the word and let it saturate your heart. You know why a lot of people are sick? Because they watch and listen and are entertained by sickness. See, the greatest sickness that you can have is not cancer. The greatest sickness that you can have is sin. Because sin is the path to all those things. Amen? Now, I'm not saying if you have those things going on in your life, you're living in sin. Don't misunderstand. But sin is what started it all in the garden. Satan cannot stand against a Christian who can say it is written and believe it. However, to be able to say it is written, you have to read it. You have to hide it in your heart and let it penetrate those rocky places and get to a point to where you believe. Man said, I believe, Lord, help thou my unbelief. How do you deal with unbelief? Chisel at it. He says, is not my word like a fire that breaks the rock into pieces? It breaks up doubt. It breaks up resistance. I know I'm extra calm today, but I feel like this is so important. Second thing is the word of God can equip us for every good work. Anything that you need to know how to do or what to do about, the word of God can equip you to do that. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Let's read that together. Go ahead and put it up for me. It says, all scripture is breathed out by God. Now that word, those breathed out by God is actually one Greek word, theopneustos, which means from the breath of God. Profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. And listen to what this says. That the man of God may be competent. How many of y'all want to be competent? Yes, amen. Equipped for every good work. See, a Christian that does not study the word, who does not get in the word and see it as a sword instead of instructions, is incompetent and unequipped. Amen. And that describes a lot of Christians. Do you want to be competent and equipped? Folks, this is the only way. Grab your sword and learn that thing. It's kind of like when Luke Skywalker first got the lightsaber, it was pretty awkward. But I tell you what, by Return of the Jedi, he had that thing down. Because he knew what it was. He learned how to use it. He saw it as a weapon. And you know the beauty of a sword? Is a sword is not just for cutting the enemy down. But it's also to defend yourself. And a two-edged sword, it doesn't matter which side you stab with. Anybody ever accidentally try to cut a steak with the wrong side of the knife? You didn't realize you had it upside down. Like, what's wrong with this thing? Oh, it's upside down. See, a two-edged sword is not like that. It'll slice. It'll dice. It'll do whatever, no matter which way you've got it turned, as long as it's in your hand. See, that's why God told Moses, what's that in your hand? God can only use what's in your hand. He cannot use what's sat down. So do you want the sword to make you competent and equipped? Then you got to put it in your hands and begin to study it. We can trust it to keep us on course. 2 Peter 1:21 basically says that this is all prophecy. It's not a private interpretation. He says, but God inspired men to write the scriptures. So in other words, there is nothing that we can do apart from scripture. You can't detach prophecies from scripture. You can't detach anything from scripture. Our life is all bound up in these words. Now, the last thing I want to share with you about the Word of God is the Bible says it's like a fire. Jeremiah 23:29. How many of y'all have one of them fake fireplaces? No, I mean, ours actually has real fire, though. I'm talking about fake flames. I love you, but fake fire is lame. It's not convincing. It does not produce any heat without some other source. It doesn't even really look good. Let's be honest. Ain't nobody buying it. Nobody looking at it saying, wow, that looks real. People walk in and say, fake. You can spot a fake from a mile away. But a real flame, real fire, he says, is not my word like a fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. Now, what is this text saying? It's saying there's no faking it. Because what's really interesting here is Jeremiah is being faced by false prophets. And they're prophesying lies. And Jeremiah's like, what makes me any different than them? They're believing them over me. And this was God's answer. My word cannot be faked. Isaiah 55:11 says, so shall my word that goes out from my mouth, that shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. Folks, that's the power of the word. It cannot fail. That's why something about this book gripped my soul, even when I wasn't saved. Because it's not fake. It's the real deal. There's no faking it. There's no substitute. It cannot be contained. That's why Jeremiah, in Jeremiah 20, verse 9, he said, your word is like a fire shut up in my bones, and I'm weary of containing it. Something happens when a word gets inside of you. It's like a penned-up tiger growling and pressing at the bars and almost breaking the lock, desperate to be loose. And when we speak it, it has power. When it's spoken in faith. And see, that's why I'm standing here today. I'm here today because God looked down and he saw a man he could use. So he put people in my path to give me the word. That's all you have to do in order to be everything that God called you to be is stop fighting. When did Paul discover his purpose? When he stopped fighting. When did Peter discover his purpose? When he stopped fighting. When did Moses discover his purpose? When he stopped fighting. And I'm here to tell you folks today to give in. Give in to what the Word says about you. Give in to everything it promises you. Surrender to it and just say, I got to a place in my life to where I said, Lord, if you don't show me how to serve you, I'm going to go crazy. Because he wasn't leaving me alone. I don't even know what the rapture was. I'd never been taught. Catholic Church doesn't much teach about the return of the Lord. Honestly, the one I went to, I don't know if they're all the same. The one I went to didn't teach much of nothing. A few rituals and pat you on the behind, send you out the door after throwing some communion down your throat. That's about the size of it. But something happened in me. Something happened in me. When this word came alive, and the same thing can happen in you. I didn't even know what the rapture was, and I had a dream. And in this dream, I saw Jesus. I don't know if it's really what he looks like, but it worked for me. I knew who it was. And I saw people coming off the ground and going off into the sky. And I was looking and I was watching and I began to get scared, and then here's something interesting that happened. Coals began to rain down on my back. Hot. I could feel it literally penetrating my skin. It was like I was awake. And I saw this old abandoned metal building, and the weird thing is, Elder Robinson, it looked just like the mower shed. I don't know if that's connected or not. But I ran toward that building. The door was unlocked, thank God. So I pull it up, and I dive in there. My back is burning, and I hear it going ping, 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 ping on the building, and I knew my time was limited. And then I heard a voice say, those that don't serve me will suffer my wrath, and I woke up in a sweat. It wasn't much long after that, a woman was handing me a Bible. God is after your heart, folks. He is after your hearts, and I'm here to tell you today, surrender. Maybe you're serving him. Maybe you're not lost like I was, but maybe you're just living below your purpose. And I'm here to tell you, it's so worth it. Surrender. Give him everything. There's nothing greater. I'm going to ask you to stand. Mike, if you could come and... the second song you did during prayer this morning, I can't remember what it was. Something about all. Yeah, you can have it all. And here in a moment, we're going to do membership, and I know it's probably late because they started the music on me. Oh, man, I'll tell you what, folks, if you could just see life from my vantage point, if you could see in you what I see in you. See, God gives shepherds this gift. He gives them this ability to see the capability that people have, and it's probably why we live in this level of frustration sometimes. Because I spend week after week calling this purpose out of you. Calling this destiny out of you. Calling this reason for living out of you. And maybe there's somebody this morning and you don't know Jesus. Maybe you're here because somebody invited you or mama drugged you. But here's what I know. Jeremiah 29:11 was in the worst of times for Israel. And he says, I know the thoughts I think toward you, says the Lord. Not to harm you. But to give you a hope and a future. If you're willing and obey, you will receive the good of the land. Now see, that land, while it is a geographical place, it's bigger than a geographical place. It's a kingdom that God has put inside of all of us to desire. I don't know exactly where to take this, but I just feel like maybe there are some you want to come forward and just worship. I'm not going to call the ministers forward today. But if there's someone that says, I want to surrender my life to Jesus today, I'd love to pray with you. And see, the thing is, here's the thing. The enemy will come at you like a flood. But what's the next part say? But the word of God will raise a standard against it. So maybe you've been going through some floods. Floods of emotional turmoil. Floods of financial disarray. Floods of family squabbles and quarrels and conflicts. But I'm here to tell you that the word of God will raise a standard against it. You want to know the interesting thing? You know what a standard is?
A law.
This is a standard. God will raise a flag and say, this one belongs to me. Just like we have protection by the military of the United States of America, we have protection of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he's waving his flag over us saying, I am your Jehovah Nissi. I am your banner. I am your standard. Maybe some of you need healing in your body. You've been sick. Actually, I am going to have the ministers going to come. Because I think some of you need ministry today. So as soon as Mike starts singing this song, if this fits you in any way, I need Jesus, I'm having some struggles, conflict in my family, God is the God of reconciliation.
You can have
anything going on in your life, I want you to come.
Lord,
I want you to come. Come now, don't wait.
Every part of my world,
Jesus.
Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours.
Everyone else, just sing.
You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world.
I really feel like there are some folks here that
take
have been struggling emotionally. The enemy has been wreaking havoc on your emotions.
Oh, the joy I found surrendering my crown at the feet of the King. Surrendered everything. All the peace that comes when I'm broken and undone by your unfailing grace.
Jesus,
I will lift my voice and say, you can have it all.
Come on, church, sing that. Every part of my world.
Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. Heart that is now yours.
I would love the opportunity to introduce somebody to Jesus this morning. To introduce you to the God that saved me in my lowest place.
You can have it all.
You are not too far away. You are not too far gone. If you have breath, you have purpose.
Take this life and bring on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and
I don't want to interrupt the flow, so we have to publicly acknowledge members in order for it to be legal. And some of the candidates are being ministered to right now, so I'm just going to let you know who we're receiving today. Caleb Eriser, Sheila Gibson, Jody Rout, Keely Willis, and Rob Bryan. They have all made application for membership. They have all been affirmed by the board. And we're going to say the membership creed together here in a minute. We did not say the declaration today, so we'll do this in its place. But I do want to share with you real quickly my covenant as a pastor with the members of this congregation. And now that you're up, if I named you, come on. Now, because I want to be able to pray for you. So Caleb, Sheila, Jody, I don't believe Keely is here. And there was one other I said. Rob, thank you. All right, if you all will face the audience. But as your pastor, I make a covenant with you. This is something I take very seriously. First of all, I make a covenant to protect the pulpit. That everything that is said, preached, ministered in it is true. The second covenant I make with you is that this will be a no-hunting zone. This means that while you're here, you will be protected, and you'll be able to worship freely and do what God has called you to do. You will be protected, not only spiritually, but physically. Another covenant I make with you is to live a life of integrity. It's worthy of the calling that I've received. Another covenant I make with you is to promote leaders that are the same. And with that, there are also some expectations from you. First of all, the scriptures are your guide. Second of all, you have been saved. Third of all, you have been baptized in water, and you're living a Christian life. You support the leaders. You're committed. You support your local church. You're committed to reaching people for the kingdom of God. So with that said, we're going to put the creed on the wall, and if all the members, everybody's already standing, so you might as well just everybody stand. And even if you're not a member, you believe these things, you can say them with us. But I'll say them and then you repeat them. I believe the scriptures are without error and contain all I need for faith and practice. I've received the gift of salvation by repenting of my sin and placing my faith in Jesus. I follow the Lord in water baptism, identifying with his death, burial, and resurrection. I live a consistent Christian life in public and in private. I support the leadership that God has given me as a gift from him. I'm committed to faithful attendance as I recognize the need for corporate worship. I support the church in my time, my tithe, and my talent. I am committed to fulfilling the Great Commission and the Great Commandment. I am committed to reaching the five people that God has placed in my life with the gospel. And that is basically something that we teach people is reach your five. That means every person has at least a minimum of five people in their life that don't know Jesus. And it's our mission to reach them with the life that you live and corporately together. So I'm going to ask the ministers and the board members to come. We're going to pray. It's really cool because each one of these brings a specific gift to the church. That's how it works. And Sheila with the ministry of flags that she's brought to Lakeside is something I actually prayed for. It's interesting how God answers prayers. Rob's helping with our security and usher team. Caleb is just an extraordinary young man. he's one of the very few people I like the day I met him. I love the way he thinks. You know what I love about him is the way he supports his wife. And then Jody and that flute, my God. We missed it the last few weeks. You don't realize how bad you miss it until you hear it. It's like, oh, there it is. What beautiful gifts you all bring to Lakeside. It's a privilege to serve as your pastor. It's such an honor to receive you as members. And these are just simple certificates. The paper doesn't mean a whole lot. And to be honest, you can serve God and not be part of the membership of the church. You don't have to join. We're not going to force you. I think there's something special about it when you choose to. But if you don't, we're still going to love you. I'll still be your pastor. But I'm going to ask you to extend your hands toward these. I'm going to ask the ministers and the board members to gather around, lay hands on them, and let's pray. Father, I thank you for these members. I thank you for what they represent. And I thank you that each of them bring a gift to Lakeside Worship Center. Each of them are a gift to Lakeside Worship Center. And Lord, as we serve as a congregation that serves you fully in everything that you are, Lord, help us to recognize how special what you're doing in our lives is. So Lord, I bless Jody. I bless Sheila. I bless Rob. And I bless Caleb. And I thank God for them. And in her absence, we bless Keely. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father, for this word. Now, if you want, your closing moment can be to come up and greet our new members, say hello to them, and then you're free to be dismissed.
Steve.